Hello and welcome back. In this video, we will proceed with our discussion of electronic states in crystalline solids. In previous videos, we saw that electrons traveling through a crystalline solid are subjected to the spatially periodic potential of the regularly arranged ions. The electron eigenstates were shown to be plane wave-like with a spatially periodic amplitudes, as elucidated by Bloch's theorem. Because real crystalline solids are composed of atoms, it is natural to speculate that the electronic orbitals of the atoms making up the crystal would play an important role in determining the final shape of the electron's Bloch states. However, Bloch's theorem does not provide information about the orbital content. Thus, we must extend it further if we desired to describe the electronic structure of real crystals. In this video, we will address this problem precisely. That is, we will develop a formalism to help us understand how Bloch states of crystals are related to the atomic orbitals of the constituent atoms. Let's get started. We begin with a simple thought experiment. Imagine we start with a crystal composed of periodically distributed atoms separated by enormous distances, as the one shown in the figure. Here, the atoms are so far away from each other that they can be treated as independent. Now, we slowly and uniformly decrease the distances between all atoms to the typical atomic spacing in real crystals found in nature. The idea of this thought experiment is to help us understand how the electronic state of a crystalline solid can be built up from the electronic states of the constituent atoms. Because the largely separated atoms of our initial hypothetical crystal do not interact with each other, we can say that the electrons will occupy the atomic orbitals of each individual atom at each unit cell of the crystal. For instance, electrons may occupy s, px, py or pz states on each unit cell in this limit. Now, when the atoms are brought together to the typical distances seen in real crystals, the atomic wave functions of electrons in adjacent atoms will interfere with each other, resulting in Bloch states with electrons extending throughout the entire crystal as plane waves with spatially periodic amplitude. To describe this transition, we begin with the largely separated hypothetical crystal and write down the wave function for the total system as a linear combination of the orbital wave functions of the individual atoms. The coefficients of the linear combination are functions of the direct lattices vectors only. Here, we have a single index n to characterize an orbital type. For example, the electron states around each atom can be of the s type. Here, the wave function is spherically symmetric and decays exponential from the nucleus located at capital R, the lattice vectors corresponding to the associated unit cell. Electrons can also sit in p-type orbital around each atom. The wave function of p-type orbitals is also shown. The linear superposition of atomic orbitals shown in the yellow box is commonly known as linear combination of atomic orbital, or simply LCAO. Although the atoms are assumed far from each other initially, they are still arranged periodically through space. Therefore, Bloch's theorem must still apply for this system. Because of this, it is now necessary to make our linear combinations of atomic orbitals consistent with Bloch's theorem. That is, we need to find a set of coefficients, C of R, such that our linear combination of atomic orbitals obey the periodicity and orthogonality conditions of Bloch states. First, let's analyze how the periodicity condition of Bloch states constrains the coefficients of the linear combination of atom orbitals. The periodicity condition is highlighted in the yellow box to the right. First, we note that Bloch's theorem enforces that the coefficients display a dependence in k, the crystal momentum. Second, the periodicity condition enforces that the coefficient of the sum of two lattice vectors is an exponential phase factor that depends on one of the lattice vectors, times the coefficient c at the second lattice vector. The exponential phase factor is the same shown in the periodicity condition of Bloch's theorem. From this condition, we see that the coefficient c must have the same property of exponential under the sum of it arguments. Hence, We choose the simplest representation for the coefficient C obeying this property as a constant times an exponential phase factor of k.r. Here, n is chosen to be the number of unit cells, which determines the spacing between different crystal momentum as described by the periodic boundary conditions for the wave function discussed in previous videos. The particular choice of the coefficient, therefore, ensures normalization for the block states. Therefore, we find that our linear combination of atomic orbitals will obey the periodicity condition of block states if it assumed the form shown in the green box. Note that we still need to enforce the orthogonality condition of block states over this linear combination of atomic orbital, before having a consistent description of our hypothetical crystals with largely separated ions. Thus, let's now analyze the orthogonality condition. The orthogonality condition of block states are highlighted in the yellow box to the right. Replacing the block states as a linear combination of atomic orbitals we found previously in the orthogonality relation, we find the following. Note that the expression depends on the overlap between atomic orbitals in distinct unit cells separated by a lattice vector, r, because the atomic orbitals are localized around each atom and the distance between the atoms is enormous in the initial system. The overlap between orbital and neighboring atoms is negligible. At the same time, the overlap between distinct orbital within the same unit cell is also zero. Therefore, we obtain the following, which implies directly that the block states constructed as linear combinations of atomic orbitals with the particular coefficients we found in the previous step already satisfies the orthogonality condition of block states. The detailed derivation of this result can be downloaded in the link description of this video. We conclude that the block states for electrons in the initial system, with largely separated ions, can be written in terms of the atomic orbital around each individual atom composing the system. We are now ready to bring the atoms together to their typical distances in real crystals and analyze the relation between plane wave-like block states and atomic orbitals. But is it true that the relation derived previously for the initial system is valid when we bring the atoms together? Well, let's explore what happens in the transition. Recall that the validity of the linear combination of atomic orbitals derived in the initial system relies on the fact that the overlap between the wave function of orbitals in different unit cells is negligible. This is true for initial configuration because the separation between the ions is assumed to be several orders of magnitude larger than the typical orbital wave function's decay length, which automatically leads to the orthogonality of block states. But in real crystals, the distance between the ions is of the same order of magnitude of the orbital wave function decay length. Therefore, we expect that the overlap between neighboring orbitals to be non-negligible, which unavoidably leads to a violation of the orthogonality relation for block states written as linear combinations of atomic orbitals as shown previously. This is sketched in the figure, where we show that the localized electron states around each atom tend to overlap and give rise to new hybrid orbitals. We conclude that the linear combination of atomic orbitals derived previously for the initial configuration is not valid for the final configuration where the atoms are close together. That meaning that linear combination of atomic orbitals does not satisfy Bloch's theorem for the final configuration. Luckily, we can avoid the problem of finite overlap between neighboring atomic orbitals by constructing orthogonal atomic orbitals. The idea is to create new localized orbitals, represented by phi bar, as a superposition of the real atomic orbitals of the atoms as shown in the orange box. The new localized atomic orbitals in neighboring unit cells have zero overlap if the coefficients of the superposition obey the above relations. We also enforce that the new modified orthogonal orbitals become indistinguishable from the real atomic orbitals when the ions are far apart. This is to ensure that the picture we had before for the linear combination of atomic orbitals for the initial system of largely distant ions is still valid. Mathematically, we also require that the coefficients become Kronecker deltas of the indexes when the atoms are far apart. A linear combination expressed in terms of the modified orthogonal orbitals ensures the validity of Bloch's theorem for the final configuration. Orthogonal orbitals constructed in this way are called Lowden orbitals, which is a theme for future discussions. Before proceeding further, we introduce the concept of overlap matrix and clarify how it relates to our discussion. A practical method to solve the Schrödinger equation is to rewrite it in matrix form. To accomplish this, we write down the total wave function as a linear combination of the non-orthogonal Bloch states psi of m and k. Combining the two equations above, we obtain a matrix equation to determine the set of wave function coefficients as well as the energy eigenvalues. The matrix equation is highlighted in the orange box, where the wave function coefficients are organized in a column vector and the Hamiltonian in the non-orthogonal Bloch basis in a square matrix whose elements are given below. Note that there is also an extra matrix, denote by capital S, appearing in the right-hand side of the matrix equation. This matrix is referred to as the overlap matrix and its elements are the brackets of non-orthogonal Bloch states with distinct band indexes. Note that the overlap matrix appears unavoidably in this formalism due to the non-orthogonality of Bloch states. If the Bloch states were orthogonal, the overlap matrix would be the identity matrix. Hence, it would not appear in the Schrödinger equation in matrix form. Our previous discussion on how to construct an orthogonal basis from the linear combination of atomic orbitals can also be visualized in terms of the overlap matrix. To construct an orthogonal basis, we defined a new column vector, C bar, which is the square root of the overlap matrix times the original column vector for the coefficients of the total wave function. Written in this way, the new set of coefficients, C bar, are obtained as linear combinations of the old set of coefficients C, with the multiplying factors being the elements of the root of the overlap matrix. This particular definition for C bar implies in the normalization conditions for the original wave function coefficients. Now, we can rewrite the matrix Schrödinger equation highlighted in the orange box in terms of the C bar column vector. In doing so, we obtain the following, which is the matrix form of the Schrödinger equation for orthogonal wave functions, C bar. The orthogonality of the eigenvectors is made clear by noticing the absence of an overlap matrix on the right-hand side of the new Schrödinger equation. Note that the Hamiltonian matrix also gets transformed by the inverse of the square roots of the overlap matrix. The procedure shown here to generate an orthogonal basis is equivalent to the one we discussed previously. Finally, the extended plane wave-like Bloch states of electrons in crystals hold information about the atomic orbitals around each atom through the linear combination of modified atomic orbitals as shown in the green box. This final expression satisfactorily describes how the interference of the localized atomic wave functions gives rise to extended Bloch states in crystals. Thus, it unifies the electron state picture of atoms and crystals. The linear combination of atomic orbitals derived here also enables us to obtain the relation between the matrix elements of the Hamiltonian and the Bloch and orbital basis. A direct application of the relation in the green box leads to the Hamiltonian matrix element highlighted in the blue box. This important relation shows that one can construct the Bloch Hamiltonian for electrons in crystals from the knowledge of the Hamiltonian in a localized basis. This is the beginning of our discussion of the tight binding method, which is an extremely powerful tool for describing electronic states in crystal. We discuss the tight binding method in upcoming videos. Stay tuned and subscribe so you will be notified of our future episodes.